Thanks a lot for coming to a mathematical talk so early in the morning. I really be thankful to speak here about this. And the topic of my talk today is more a to-do list than providing unfinished wisdom to the audience. And I'm glad that a lot of people doing crypto parties and stuff like this. And so I want to push your attention also to a crypto event taking part today at 1400, and Hanno will make some remarks about this at the end of my talk. And it fit really very perfectly, because we had the situation, which is a bit surprising, that in the Snowden discussion, Edward Snowden made a statement not only that crypto works, or even that crypto is not an ancient art, it's a basic protection, is a defense against magic, against bad and dark attacks against us. And so you might ask, if crypto can deal with this, is it something like a kind of magic and we need people wearing funny hats to present it? And the solution is surprisingly nice. It's not magic, it's mathematics. And in mathematics, in a very beautiful form, and to make it also from a standpoint as a scientist, to make very clear, if we use crypto in an appropriate way, we can dramatically change the world in which we communicate. Our digital world can dramatically change from a situation where secret agencies and other organizations wiretap everything, with a world where the secret agencies wiretap everything and can do it nothing. And I make it in this small Python statement. If you encrypt with RSA a message and send it out, and it is a wiretrap, this communication, they can only recognize very long, very beautiful random. And so this is really a dramatic game changer. And for us and in the crypto research community, is the question now a very central one, that our work has become so important that we really should take a good consideration what are the social impacts in our work. And I'm very happy that my work is in a field where scientific advances help the weaker persons. In the most scientific fields, you have the situation if you develop something new, it usually helps the powerful people. In the case of cryptography, it helps really, by definition, the people to defend against very powerful, very powerful attacker against our system. To make it very clear, even in our smart card, in our SIM, in our mobile phones, can encrypt with a very simple algorithm in a way that secret agencies cannot access to the communication there in the air. To be very clear, crypto solves not every kind of problems. So the main purpose is now how to use crypto in an environment where the secret agencies wiretrap everything. And so my idea is really to present some stuff which helps the weaker people to empower the confrontation with the secret agencies. And the situation is not so bad. It's becoming much better than, for instance, for 2 years ago. We have a lot of fields in where we cryptographer has to do some work, but in some fields we have really remarkable results within the last time, and even better, a lot of our results is now put to internet standards and stuff like this. The main point I want to address is that we should ban a weak crypto. This is a field where we can really change the whole game by setting a check on the right place. In most cases, is just deactivating SC4, a solution for the problem field in the area of semantical crypto. We have, battery? Oops, I love my Linux. So, second part is the field of hash functions. That is a bit scary situation, but even this field is getting better. Problem field I have really also a long tradition to rant about is elliptical curve crypto. In this field, we have a total mess. The total mess is generated by the National Institute of Standards. If the National Institute of Standards standardizes a vector, which is very open and easy to see, then they have to deal with the problems that nobody trusts their parameters. And in the field of elliptical curve cryptography, we have a lot of critical parameters. And if we don't trust the organization which provides us this critical parameter, we are in deep problems. So elliptical curve is something where a lot of interesting research is going on. Nevertheless, it's a field where I have a lot of worries about. The last two parts are post-quantum cryptography. I think we should think about post-quantum cryptography now. I don't know exactly in which state the attackers' quantum computers are, but the engineering mindset in me says that it's good to be safe. It's better to be safe than sorry. So I think we have now the time to invest some money for strange mathematicians developing strange algorithms, so we can deal better also in a world where quantum computers are a real problem. To make a short explanation, a quantum computer would dramatically break not only RSA on Diffie-Hellman, but even breaks in a earlier step, all elliptical curve cryptography, so it's an interesting thing to put there some efforts in. And I want to close with some optimistic remarks. I think we have some social protocols and some advanced cryptography which could be very helpful to generate an environment in a digital world. How can we eliminate a weak crypto in our ciphers? I have written on these slides of the last millennium, and I give a talk about Windows security today in the evening, and I have realized that the two main problems in the actual patch disaster of Microsoft are really coming from the old crypto wars, the freak attack, and the second thing is using very weak hash functions. So it's a very interesting point that even the transformation away from weak ciphers could lead to a lot of practical problems we should also take into consideration. Bad symmetrical crypto can be solved in a pretty easy way. We should simply ban RC4. This is an old request by the cryptographic research community, which comes now to internet standards which disallow using RC4, and that's a good thing. If you take a look in the history of RC4, it's an amazing, brilliant idea of Warren Rivers, but from an engineering standpoint, it's much too elegant to be very secure, and actual research results show that our worries I have announced directly after the Snowden case, the idea that the NSA can break RC4 in real time might be a good consideration, as Bruce Schneier mentioned. So simply just don't use RC4. We have RIS. RIS, there are some cryptographic worries, but they are far away from practical use. I would really suggest to use RIS 256. Some cryptographers say 128 is also a good solution, but I have the main idea, if you can really spend some processor cycle, I think using longer keys is a very good idea. And to make a small hacker remark, if you don't trust RIS, then you have, from a mathematical hacker standpoint, the idea to combine two systems that the attacker has to break both, or at least the harder one. And if you combine this two ciphers with XOR, you can simply prove that an attacker has to break the strongest of both algorithms. And if you have a commutative solution, it's easy to see that an attacker has to break both ciphers if you XOR it in an appropriate mode. You should check that a bit, but I think it's funny that was one point where I have not been sure if I have been too paranoid to announce this construction using a two-fission IIS encryptophone. Nevertheless, it's interesting to see that it's also a wide-used solution in TrueCrypt, and I was really very flashed when I heard that Edward Snowden and Bruce Snyder have discussed in Harvard about the idea to cascade ciphers in the appropriate way. Bruce Schneier has criticized this. I fear he was, he might be right, but on the other hand, I'm sure that the construction which has been suggested by me and other researchers will provide a warm and fuzzy feeling in that field. Oops, sorry. So, next point is a bit scary. I've thought a lot of time for a better word to present this, but I give you some background information. We have the dramatic situation that SHA-1 and MD5 is broken in a way that you can attack it in a successful way on a standard PC. That is totally broken. MD5, it's well known, there have been, but also in the field of SHA-1, results in the last years have shown that these attacks are deeply practical. Some years ago, there was a presentation by Applebaum and other researcher shown that you can attack the certification framework of an organization using MD5, and you can dance almost the same story also on SHA-1, and this is an actual problem. How actual is it? Yeah, as I mentioned, I give a talk about Windows 10 in the evening, and I think in March there was an update from Microsoft going away from SHA-1. And to be very clear, I think it's now 20 years that they're using really a totally broken function. Now we have the really funny situation that the SHA-1 function is designed by the NSA. Even there is a funny story. The first proposal from the NSA was there and was presented, was in the standard procedure, and they said, oh, well, we have forgotten something, and added, I think, a rotation on a strange place, making the system stronger without giving a good explanation. So we're using an NSA function where we... I'm pretty sure that there are only few fields where the NSA has an advance about the public research, and I fear in the field of hash function that might be a case. If you take a look at the analysis of Stuxnet, you find some techniques which are pretty interesting. The NSA has used some really hardcore crypto stuff to attack here a system in a way where it has not been necessary. So they have really shown that they have tools which has not been necessary in a practical sense. So I can really state out that the hash functions is a field where a lot of good research, or good or evil research, has been taking part in the NSA. Why I tell this story? Because the hash function, which is now used by Microsoft, SHA-265, is also designed by the NSA and has similar design to SHA-1. And the funny thing is that the NIST has stated out that the SHA-3 competition has been necessary because they are worried that somebody would break SHA-265. And for some years there have been no results, but we have now the situation to SHA-265 is an NSA proposal which has not been nearly as good analyzed than the other ciphers. And this is something what makes me also a bit worried. Funny thing is, I told you that it's sometimes a strange idea. I have used sometimes to do things double when I don't understand how secure it really is. The funny thing is that, as you might know, SHA-256 is the main algorithm, or one of the main algorithms in Bitcoin. And the funny thing is, because the cryptographer behind Bitcoin are also pretty paranoid, they use it in a double way. So even if we have problems with SHA-265, the guys of Bitcoin has done it double. And so there is, in the case of Bitcoin, a security margin, even if the NSA would have evil ideas against SHA-2. Nevertheless, it's not a very satisfying situation. Things might be coming better. The SHA-3 function is a new function in the open competition with good explanation. There have been some worries regarding influence of NIST on the SHA-3 process, but main critic points have been addressed by the NIST, and so SHA-3 might be a good idea. It's totally other designs than SHA-1 and MD5 and SHA-265. By the way, it has been a requirement for SHA-3 competition not being such designs as the NSA design cipher. And this is a very interesting proposal. So I think SHA-3 would be the best solution. Nevertheless, it's a very new function. It's a new hash function in town, and so we should really invest also time and effort to analyze it in an appropriate way. But at the time now, I would really recommend to use SHA-3. Okay, coming to the ECC mess. You know I'm one of the minor fraction of cryptographers which are pretty critical regarding elliptical curves. One problem I have at the moment, we have caught the NIST by standardizing a backdoor, and a very dilettantic design backdoor. We could not trust the NIST regarding critical parameters in the field of elliptical curves anymore. Point. This is something also NIST employees have stated out, that they have to work on trust in a new way. The good news is, in a cryptography, there might be a mathematical solution also for these problems. In the competition, for instance, for the RAS, Advanced Encryption Standard, there was one requirement to justify that your parameters are constructed in a way that there is not a backdoor possible. That was an official requirement, and we have to go back to the elliptical curves cryptography, and we have to invest a lot of research in this field, and we have to have really proof that some parameters are constructed in a way that they're not providing a backdoor. To be very clear, why do we need standardization? One, because elliptical curve is very complicated. Second, besides this security consideration, it's another a minefield in the field of elliptical curves are, I think, some 100 patents in that field. And this is for practical use. It's useful that somebody else checking this legal nightmare of patents. If we have a standardization, the NIST takes care about a lot of problems in the patent stuff. So even if you say, I'm not caring about crazy mathematicians saying some elliptical curve cryptography might not be secure enough, you should really take care that you use standardized stuff if you not want to be involved in heavy lawsuits. And to make a mathematical evaluation about the most patents which has been in the field of elliptic curves is very short, and most of them are totally ridiculous. A different base representation is not something what a mathematician would accept patent, and even in this field we should have a good discussion how to deal with this software and algorithm patents. And as I mentioned, we need elliptical curve standardization also for this problem stuff. On the other hand, we have good news. There is a lot of research going on in Europe regarding elliptical curves. There are good research by Lange and Dieter Bernstein, for instance. There are also excellent work by Brainpool. And I think it's important that we can go to a place where we have also European standardization efforts to do this. There has been a lot of work done by the European cryptographic communities, and we should bring them now to standardization process. Another remark is we should take a close look. Bruce Schneier has really stated, I think, for more than 20 years, we should use RSA, well understand crypto where we can, and we should use elliptical curve in fields where we are very limited. So I would really make the suggestion to use RSA or even another forgotten brother of RSA, Rabin scheme, which is heavily based on in the field of of Rabin, it's equivalent to factorization. This is the stuff we have understood for decades. It's the stuff which is simple to implement. Even the key generation is really very, very simple. It can be presented in one lesson if you give a cryptographic course at a university. And this is a nice comparison. I need about 40, 50 minutes to present as a key generation to my students. I have advised the first elliptical curve mathematical diploma thesis in 1999 or so. I don't understand elliptical curve even though I have dealt with them then for almost 20 years. There are a huge amount of parameters. They are really very critical. And even if you do 20 years of research in the field of number theory, you should be very careful. And without joking, I would make the statement, everybody which has a deep knowledge in elliptical curves has more worries than people use it in a heavy way. Nevertheless, elliptical curve is an interesting proposal, and I heavily support research in this field, and I think that is also a place where research should throw some money in, because elliptical curve is really very important in a lot of fields where we have really limited an environment, for instance, Internet of Things, to make this magical best word, is important to have good elliptical curves. Nevertheless, even if we have a device like a mobile phone or something else, I should make the statement that we should stick for SA 4096 for some more decades. I think even the propagandistic evaluation of ECC performance will show that for instance, for checking RSA signatures with a low low public exponent, I'm not sure if elliptical curves are are faster in all the scenarios. And I want to make also the remark that Rabin uses a public exponent too. It's even quicker than checking RSA with low public exponents. Last 5 minutes, so I come to quantum computing in the last 5 minutes, what is a bit a pity, because quantum computing is one very interesting research field. And, oops, sorry, oops. So, sorry. Quantum computing is a very interesting field. To make a short explanation of this, at the moment, it looks like if we have quantum computers, all our normal cryptography is dramatically broken. RSA is broken, Diffie-Hellman is broken, but something I really want to make a very loud remark about is, if we have quantum computers, they will very quicker attack elliptical curves cryptography, because they are much shorter keys, 2056 in a lot of environments compared to 4069. So it's very clear if you have quantum computers, we will have really problems with elliptical curves much earlier than with other fields. And I will want to make an additional proposal. I think we have a lot of optimization possibilities to attack elliptical curves even quicker than the actual research. Is elliptical curve, is quantum cryptography even quicker than now is the state of the art in cryptographic research. Last some slides is a very funny thing. I saw in these days that this crazy stuff of mathematicians jumping around and saying if we have quantum computers, we have problems, have now come also to Microsoft. Microsoft has the first time make a real proposal of post-quantum cryptography, Microsoft Research, and they have also presented implementation for TLS. And it's interesting to have the parameters there. If you take a look on the in the paper, we are now down to 8 kilobyte big messages and about a performance penalty of 21%. And this is very good because in the older days we had to throw megabytes of data if you're using this very very skilled and very fascinating post-quantum cryptography. Last remark to post-quantum cryptography is we can think to design protocols which survive quantum computing attacks. And one scary thing is I have been asked for Wall Street Journal Germany to make an evaluation about the security of Bitcoin. And I make the statement, yes, there are problems because Bitcoin using elliptical curve cryptography with 265 if we have quantum computers, but the whole system is designed in a way that even a break in this field will not attack the whole economic philosophy behind Bitcoin. And so it's really interesting if we take a look at Bitcoin, we can learn how to design crypto which also survives quantum cryptography. By the way, the headline in the article in Wall Street Journal was a researcher warns because of quantum computer regarding elliptical curves cryptography. Yeah, I have warned, but the statement that Bitcoin will have much lesser problems than normal money systems have been not brought to a very central point. I don't want to make a final statement about Bitcoin, but in a cryptographic field, these are nice people. These are people which deep, not too deep knowledge in crypto, and they know that they don't have too deep knowledge in crypto, then design it in a conservative, best engineering way. And these are a kind of the best cryptographic engineers you can have. So the cryptography in Bitcoin is some construction which makes me sometimes smile, and that is not often the case if you take a look at implementation. So coming to the final, really final, I'm a bit in overtime already, remarks what we should do, only some statements. We have advanced cryptography which can be used to model social corporations in a better way. One of the few things which is in heavy use is OTR. In OTR, we have really built with advanced cryptographic protocols things like non-reduplication that we can really discuss in a way where we have some kind of authentication of message, but revocable authentication of message, which makes gives us a chance to model communication off the record, so that you can say something without have the problem that somebody could take your statement and bring you to court. And from a philosophical standpoint, it's important to try to bring some concepts of a private talk also to the cryptographic world, and Borisov and Ian Goldberg have done fantastic work in this field. There is also very cool stuff in the field of blind signatures, and this is the second time I smile in this talk, because I was a bit angry that nobody used and implements a blind signature over the last 20 years. And the good news is now 20 years are over. Most of the scary software patents have been gone, so we can use a blind signature without legal problems because we have spent so much time not implementing it. And so I think it's a good thing to think about electronic voting. I'm a bit disappointed that some nice ideas of the Pirate Party, like liquid feedback, didn't make the next step to use advanced cryptographic technique to model democratic processes. But maybe we can find some time more. The good thing is the software and the ideas are still available, and next generation might do it in a better way. Can we give this requirements for Edward Snowden? We have a moral, philosophical, and technical commitment to do it. And yeah, I don't want to make jokes about it. I take it serious. We are hackers, are mathematicians. We are friendly people which want to hack sometimes and sit in the sun in a camp. But now we are in a big battle. In a big battle of our internet. And the problem is the internet is not, maybe a problem, maybe a feature. It's not only our nice playground, it had huge implications on the whole society. And yes, I think we have a moral, philosophical, and technical commitment to do it. And so this is the point where I ask Hanno to come to the to the stage, if he's still here. And in that sense, I want really to make the request to you. Use your skills and make the world a better place. Can we do this, what he's asked for? And I think, yes, we can. Thank you for your attention.
Yeah. I just want to make a very quick announcement. We will have an open crypto meeting at 2 o'clock in workshop 10-3. Which is just like get people interested in crypto to discuss like what are the newest attacks on TLS and what new algorithms are interesting. Whatever you want to discuss, open crypto meeting at 2 o'clock in workshop 10-3.
Okay. We still have a few minutes left, so if you have any questions, quick, short questions, please line up on the microphones, either on the left or the right.
a remark on the ring learning with errors thing. Rudy here.
Ah, sorry.
As far as I know, this is patented too, so that's kind of bad, the Microsoft ring learning with errors thing.
So the reason most websites today use...
It was only a sign that Microsoft takes some considerations to do this to stuff which has been really very esoteric mathematical concepts so long. If there are patents, we have the normal problems there. Not as a good thing. I have not evaluated the Microsoft proposal. I think it, on the first look, it is very optimistic what they do. I'm not sure it's a good idea. The only statement I want to give is that Microsoft now tries to evaluate and implement stuff which has been esoteric mathematician for a long time.
Okay, Rudy, just one statement. Maybe it's on quantum cryptography. Isn't it supposed to be actually very resistant to man-in-the-middle attack? Because when you actually have two entangled quantum particles, it is very hard to actually carry out an MITM, because if you change one, then you affect the other. And do you see that perhaps in future this could be, it could become a standard which will be used to avoid such kind of attacks?
Yeah, we had to think into that direction. It's very hard to give a short answer. Yet one pessimistic thing is if we have quantum computer, every
cryptographic operation we use in public key cryptography, elliptical curves or SA ultima, is completely broken. Completely broken in the sense of completely broken that you get the secret key as a private key and to go to everything. Your question is interesting in that field that like in Bitcoin or other protocols, you can modify these protocols in a way to make even a completely break of the public key cryptography not so harmful for the whole construction, but this is even challenging cryptographic research. Yes, thank you.
The reason most websites today use ECC in their ciphers is because the size needed to transmit during connection setup is so big if you use RSA-based things, and it gets bigger if you use another key, like DHA. Mm. Do we have a perspective how to solve it? Because currently we are all using ECC and can't go back to RSA.
To make following statement, maybe this is a bit of an angry cryptographer. We talk about 4069 bit RSA versus
2K.
I have recommended 4006, but even 2K.
4K is even worse.
4K is
in the regard to how much traffic you need to transfer.
Traffic transfer. Come on, you make one key exchange at the beginning of the show, and then you stream gigabyte on gigabyte of Games of Thrones cats video content. And yes, we cryptographers should go into the edge because we...
My mobile phone doesn't have that much traffic.
Your mobile phone is much more powerful than my original IBM ThinkPad
yes,
I have
CPU
here.
Yes, CPU-wise, but we are talking about traffic.
Now, without joking, to be very clear, making your point in a more even more aggressive way is using RSA with 4068-bit might harm our climate. Yes, it might have influence on using millions and billions of money for cryptographic operation. And to be very clear, I think we might have systems where we have a long time as a 256 key and using for perfect private secrecy ECC curves with 256. But I really would heavily recommend that we have a long time secrets and signature keys. We should make a heavily use of SR4069. And as I mentioned, if we have environments where there are environments in the Internet of Things where RSA 4069 is too heavy. For this field, it might be a good idea to have also elliptical curve. And this is a statement from Bruce Schneier. If you have the options, use RSA. If you have no options, or if you have the option to use no crypto or elliptical curve crypto, use elliptical curve crypto. And I think this statement is still right, but it's an ideological discussion in cryptography, and I admire that I have the minority position in this. Thank you.
The practical problem... Yeah, sorry.
Last question, please.
Thanks. You're... made it very clear that you're hesitant using elliptic curves in crypto. Does that only apply to the NIST standardized curves, or are you also hesitant regarding like ED25519, Goldilocks and stuff like that?
To be very clear, a lot of critic in this talk, and I focus really on the standardization problem, is not valid for Lange and DGB. Crypto is not valid, it's not a critic. They do fantastic work, to be very clear. They should be heavily supported. They're doing, by the way, also interesting stuff in quantum cryptography. I heavily supported, don't get me wrong. Even though if I would be right to be as a is a more conservative and more secure thing, I had really make the statement that we have an, in a lot of fields where we heavily need elliptical curve, and so we should use really a brain pool curves which have announced some problems, and DGP has really announced all the requirements I've said to be backdoor free and so on. Read DGP's paper in this field is very interesting and very good point to do for further research. To be very clear, the critic regarding standardization is not valid for DGP and not valid for brain pool curves.
So it's just the not rigidity of the curves and these standardized curves that we have to use because we don't have TLS 1.3 still yet.
Yes, but we have to address it, and as I mentioned, this problematic situation is also visible inside the NIST and is also there, and we should continue to have pressure on NIST because NIST has done fantastic work for decades. It's very helpful for the whole humankind, to be very clear. And that is one mistake, and we should give them the chance to come back. But it's not possible that they present any parameter which could have a backdoor without heavily where there's not a backdoor. And by the way, this is the official policy of NIST regarding the RIS competition. So what we ask with power behind is just the position they have mentioned before.
Thanks.
Okay, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for your attention.